Hachette Audio presents An Ordinary Wonder, written by Buki Papillon and read by Adjoa Andoh. For Julian, for Margaret and Samuel Olajide, for Mubo, Jumoke, Muiwa, and Molora, you are my beating heart. Part 1. A person who sells eggs should not start a fight in the market. Chapter 1. Now, 1991, age 14. My name is Otto Loring. I've been called Monster. Within dark valleys of flesh, I defy the given. A snake curled in upon itself. Two in one, mythical and shunned. Yet in that magical place between worlds, in the realm where the great mother gives milk to her offspring, I become like a goddess. There, in words unspoken, my voice is heard. I often wish I could take Wura, my sister, with me, to visit that place where I truly come alive, but I cannot, because Wura is normal. So it would be death. Wura and I are twins. Like all other Yoruba twins that have ever been born, we should be called Taiwo and Keinde, the one who came first and the one who lagged behind. Even in this, our natural names, our parents kept us apart. Otto Loring, one who walks a different path, and Wura Ola, a wealth of gold. Wura is everything to our mother, who will never have any other children because she is the woman who birthed the unspeakable, and my father has no desire to sire any more monsters. Here in Nigeria, the road ends at my secret. But America, they say, is a land where wonders are created and the wondrous is made ordinary. Now that I have wedged one foot onto that path, I am determined to make it all the way, because if I do, perhaps I too can become an ordinary wonder. Chapter 2. Before. 1989, age 12. In our house, there was nothing as dangerous as the truth. I'd slipped into Wura's room, though I was supposed to stay out of sight in mine. Backlit by the soft September sun, her party dress beckoned like a hibiscus to be plucked. Pink blushing to rose at the hem, buttons like dewdrops down the back, a crimson sash. In a day, we turned 12. Weeks earlier, surrounded by the freshwater scent of new fabric at Ibadan's top tailor, my twin sister had selected the exact dress I'd have chosen, had anyone asked. She would dazzle like a princess at our party, and I would be the brother trussed up in a suit. Not that I hated trousers. They're useful for tree climbing and playing football, but I also long to wear a dress sometimes. Okay, most times. Surely, whispered a little voice in my mind, Wura won't mind if you try the dress on, just to see. In fact, she might think it fun. And that was like mother's driver denying he'd been drinking kai-kai when the fumes on his breath could dry the water off your eyeballs. Wura would share her last bite of coconut candy with me. But if I touched her stuff without permission, her rage was roof-shattering, like Samson in the Bible. Yet how we'd both gasped the moment Wura opened the catalogue page to that dress. Minutes earlier, standing before my bedroom window, I'd seen Mother slide into the back seat of her Mercedes, watched it shoot down the driveway in Mr. Driver's typical gunfire fashion. Watched the huge truck that had brought dozens of rental chairs rumble sedately out behind it like a disapproving old auntie. The gateman shut the gate, and I could finally escape. Mother would be gone for a while. Bura padded silently in. This was the best and the worst thing about being twins. We rarely surprised each other. She smoothed the sash on her dress, eyed me warily. Can I try it on? It popped out of my mouth. No, just for a minute. Bura's lower lip vanished under the top one. It was unfair to ask. Mother said Jehovah God would punish us all if she encouraged my sinful habits. I was maybe 5 the first time it happened. Mama Ondo, my grandmother, had been visiting. She'd set aside her wig, orange headscarf still tied on, while she napped on the cool veranda. I'd never realized till then that she sometimes wore one. I'd been shocked by the sight of her scalp, bald all around the edges, as if someone had plucked her clean. I'd arranged the wig on my head, tiptoed to the hallway mirror, and as the world slid into proper focus, made the happy discovery that I was, in fact, a girl. I'd promptly named myself Lori and raced off to spread the good news, confident everything would now be fixed. You're not a girl, Otolorin. You're a boy, Mother had hissed. And if you ever repeat those words or let anyone see your privates, I'll lock you outside at night for Bombo Bombo to steal. That brought weeks of nightmares. I was never sure afterwards if I dreamed of my grandmother in a long white robe, standing before a small fire in the backyard, the wig she'd thrown on it, spitting flame, before curling up like a small dying animal. I tried my best since to forget about Lori, but it was like trying to turn off a broken tap. The feelings just kept flowing. Please, I pulled the big sad eyes Bura could never refuse. She'd hoped I'd say, never mind, forget it. Then she'd exile herself with me to my room, and we'd play snakes and ladders and pretend I'd never asked. But I couldn't. Because maybe, if I saw Lori again, just for one sweet moment in that heavenly dress, then I could go back quietly to being Otto. Her fists clenched, then released. All right then, off with your clothes. I stripped immediately to my underwear before she could change her mind. Have you heard, skinny bones? Bura tickled my ribs. She was pretending this was a game. I wasn't trying to be someone else, just her silly brother playing dress up. Heard what? Opolenge fell on a plate, but he was so scrawny the plate felt insulted and refused to break. We erupted with giggles, knowing she might as well be poking fun at her own body. As she carefully slid the dress off its hanger, brows beetled with concentration, it was like watching myself. Big brown eyes with looping curly lashes, nose dabbed on like an afterthought above pillow puff lips. Only my jaw was a touch squarer, where hers was perfectly curved like the bottom of an egg. Her hair was done up in 2 beribboned buns, mine cut low. As for the down below parts, who knew? It was never talked about. Bura's dress slid on like warm water. Impatient to turn around and see myself in the mirror, I looked down at my feet, which, sadly, had always been a size larger than hers. I wish I had strappy white sandals. Hey, stop wiggling like a fish, or the dress will tear. I heard a gasp. Mother stood at the door. She must have forgotten something. Her eyes thinned to slits, her face curled like lit paper. Wara's hands trembled on my back, our hearts battering at our ribs. I'm dead, I thought. You wicked child! Mother screamed. In 2 strides, she'd seized my shoulders, shaking till it was an earthquake, and my teeth rattled like shakere beads. I broke away, but a hand hooked into the neck of Wura's dress. Buttons pinged everywhere. No, please, Wura's dress, it's not her fault. She slapped my mouth shut, yanked harder. The dress ripped top to hem, slap, rip, slap, till I was cringing in blue Y-fronts and one torn sleeve.
Mommy, please, stop beating him,
Wura sobbed. You, shut up and don't move. I'll deal with you later. Mother pushed me out of the room, down the hallway, to the edge of the landing. The last time she was really angry, she'd hauled me to the kitchen, taken a wooden ruler to my palm, then made me husk a sack of groundnuts with my stinging hands. It took till the next morning. Fast, like something mechanical, her hands shot out. I flailed, reached for a railing, found only air. Then I was tumbling. I hit the bottom with a squelchy crack and popped out of my body in a flash of light so strong I was blinded. Then I could see better than ever before, and the air around me was super-shined into a swelling silver-blue tunnel of tiny stars. I floated towards the big star, blinking at the end. So beautiful. A piercing scream made me wish I still had hands to clasp to my ears. Hurrah! I was rudely thrust back into the small body lying at the bottom of the stairs. Where did all the lovely blue and silver go? Someone picked me up. The ride to the clinic was a long, bumpy haze of pain. He fell down the stairs, Mother told the doctor. He was too excited about his birthday party tomorrow. Okay, Otto. This will hurt, but bear up. The tall, long-faced man felt around my shoulder, and pain swallowed me.
Mommy! Mommy!
I cried, needing a mother to save me, to hold me close and tell me all would be well. The doctor mercifully let go. Mother didn't move from her chair. Her face was twisted like a wrong scarf. I had a sick feeling that the switch in her head with my name on it, which used to hover around bad, had now flipped to worst. She'd never gone this far before. He'll be fine, Mrs. Akinro. The doctor swabbed my arm, smiling at Mother, mesmerized as a bug by the flame of her beauty. It wasn't an uncommon reaction. Mother squeezed out a smile. She wouldn't leave my side for a second, but not for reasons the doctor thought. He slipped a long needle into my arm. Be brave for your mother now, little man. No more falling downstairs in the future. My eyelids fluttered. The sharp white walls of the clinic wavered and faded. The table became a cottony cloud, wrapped itself securely around me, and together we rose upwards, soaring above the trees and people who soon looked like ants on the ground. Somewhere, far below, was a doctor with his needle and a mother who hated her child, and I'd left them all behind. My cloud disappeared, and I was falling. Below, gentle waves caught the light, and the sea shimmered blue, green, silver. I spun head over toes. I should be scared, but all I felt was eagerness. Sleek as an eel, I slid in. The water carried me with a strange grace, yielding yet supporting. I found my balance, stood upright, turned and twisted to look around. Tiny fish darted by, unconcerned with my presence. I think one winked at me. In the distance, I saw shapes that could be houses, pale, watery as though made of glass or ice that wasn't frozen. Nothing was what it seemed to be. Down here, the world gleamed brighter, sharper, clearer, the way it only ever looked when the sun came out after the first heavy rains that followed the dry season. Reds seared, yellows shone, and purples looked wax-polished. Voices babbled softly, sweetly in my ear, but I saw no one. I looked at myself in those glass walls, and I was beautiful. Long plaits down my back, pearl shells on my chest, bangles on my wrists. I searched my mind for the meaning of this. Where was I? I must really be dead this time. No other explanation made sense. It wasn't so bad, after all, to be dead. Then, in the corner of my eye, I saw movement, quick as light, gone when I blinked. She played with me like that for a while, before she let me see her. She was a woman, but then again, she wasn't. Her long, slim arms gleamed with an impression of pearly scales. Shells covered her breasts. Her sweeping fins and tail flashed a multitude of colors, silver, red, electric blue, like the betta fish I once saw in a book. Sea anemones wrapped like living rubber bands around the ends of her long, gleaming plaits. One lazily waved its tentacles. I'd never seen anything so astonishing and beautiful. Yet she felt strangely familiar. Who was she? "Call me Yeyemi," she said, without words. "You are safe, here between worlds, at the parting of the veil. You may rest, but only for a time." Then I was back in the real world, lying woozy-headed in the car, and all that remained was a lingering sense of light and joy. I longed to return to that wonderful place. Our birthday dawned bright and clear. Tall loudspeakers all over the courtyard boomed with Ebenezer Obey's latest release. People came and went, chatting, eating, drinking. All I could do was sit under the plumeria trees and watch. Two boys came to ask about my sling, probably children of father's business partners in Ibadan. Bored, they soon wandered off. From when I could talk, mother warned me never to let anyone get close enough to start asking questions. If we got asked to parties, mother took wura and said I was sick. People thought me a sickly child. Years ago, in primary school, I'd had a real friend and invited him home. Rashid was always alone too, and so nervous he was practically mute, though I sensed the busyness of deep thoughts scurrying through his mind, just like mine. His tribal scarification marks, four across each cheek, made other kids meanly tease him. When mother asked if he'd like some Fanta, he'd whispered, "Yes." She'd frowned. In my room, he'd whispered, "Let's play mummies and daddies. You lie down and I'll climb on top." "Now what?" I asked. "We move like this." He thrashed his arms and legs like a swimming frog. It wasn't much fun, but I was glad to have a friend. "Now you're going to have a baby," he said. We'd rolled up a towel and shoved it under my t-shirt. I'd waddled around like I'd seen pregnant women do, holding my sides, groaning with great drama. Rashid laughed so hard, I got carried away and waddled past the window. Outside, wura looked up and guffawed. Mother, unfortunately, was beside her. She'd been up in seconds, screaming, "Unnatural creature, son of disgrace!" Rashid trembled as if in a fit. Then there'd been this dripping noise, and he'd peed his pants. Rashid stopped speaking altogether in school and ran off if he saw me. That hurt long after the welts from mother's shoe faded from my back. I'd wanted to let him know it was okay, that I'd never tell anyone he peed himself. He didn't return after the holidays. A girl blew a party horn near my ear, then ran off laughing. It brought out a smile I didn't know I had inside me. Everyone was having such a good time, even Mother, radiant with smiles since Father arrived early morning from Lagos. He sat with the most important guests, wearing a gold lace agbada. He said something to Mother, who shouted for Emily the maid to bring more beer. She loved every second of shining beside him in her matching gold lace iro and buba, knowing how people envied her big round eyes, her brows arched like birds' wings, her smooth as camwood skin, the pillow puff lips Wora and I had inherited, though she probably wished I hadn't, and her tall, handsome husband, smooth as okra soup. A couple of young women guests came to bend their knees before him in greeting, acting all shy and fluttery. Mother's hand latched onto his arm. Roving praise singers stood nearby, thumping out Father's importance on talking drums. Lustrous black jewel of immeasurable value, majestic owner of palatial houses, great hunter whose quiver is full of sons and daughters, etc., etc. They somehow always knew to show up when there was a party. Father rose, smiling smugly, plastered naira notes to their sweaty foreheads. I'd once heard the gateman mutter how he's like the scorpion that can't help stinging to death the very frog on whose back it's crossing the river. I had to say, it described Father quite well. I'd heard the gossip about his biggest business competitor, who just upped and vanished. No one knew if he was dead. A journalist, who insisted on investigating Father, was found floating face down in Ogunpa River after heavy rains, though people got early warning for once and fled before it overflowed. To me, Father was as remote as Mars and twice as hostile. The year we turned 5, he was leaving on one of his never-ending business travels and asked Wora what she wanted him to bring back. She asked for ribbons and a fairy tale castle with a real princess inside that we'd seen advertised on an American TV cartoon series. Because I'd not fully understood, I was barely to be seen and definitely not heard, I piped up that I wanted exactly the same. He looked at me, like a person stares at the sole of his shoe after stepping in vomit. He never returned to live with us. It took time for Wora to figure out I'd not literally driven him away, as Mother ranted, and for a time, she resented me with all the pain her 5-year-old heart could muster. It was the worst feeling. Mother locked me in my room for a whole week with only water and dry bread to eat. That was when I really began to draw. At first, it was to keep my mind off being hungry. Then I drew, not to be afraid. Then I drew, to stem the loneliness and the hurt. I covered whole notebooks. Again and again I practiced eyes, then hands, then bodies, then movement. Feeling, tasting and testing the shape of life through my pencils and crayons, it was an intoxication to realize I was a creator. I could make exist whatever I wanted. Afterwards, Mother told everyone Father had moved to Lagos because his business had grown too big to handle from Ibadan. The rare times he visited and they talked privately, I'd put my ear to the door and listen because according to my precious book of Yoruba proverbs, it was because the kite had its ear on the wind that it didn't perish in the brush fire. Mother, sobbing, asked once if he planned to leave her dangling for the rest of her life. Father icily replied,
"Forget it, Moji. I will not further besmirch the Akinoro name by siring another monster."
I'd had to look up siring and besmirch. Monster, I understood, just fine. Father loved using big words. As the praise singers scooped up the last naira notes and moved on, Emily, Mother's maid, emerged from the house hauling a large tub and handed out green bottles glistening with cold sweat. The men around Father nodded like agama lizards in agreement with whatever he was saying. Probably his tired old joke that if we'd had the sagacity to be born in the dry season instead of September, we'd have saved in the yearly cost of renting canopies. They always laughed as if they'd never heard it before, knowing full well that Father could buy up every canopy in Ibadan with just his pocket change. For sure, the plentiful food would be talked about for months. Jollof rice with golden fried slices of dodo, pounded yam with spinach and melon seed stew, amala beaten until fluffy and served with bitter leaf soup and smoked fish. All prepared by the hired caterers fondly known as Olowo Shibi, women born with cooking spoons in hand. The clanging of their giant cooking pots had woken us at dawn. The whiff of wood smoke still lingered in the air. It all smelled tasty, but struggling out of my chair was too painful. I was wondering if I'd practiced so hard at being invisible that I'd actually vanished when Wura showed up with a plate of jollof rice, spicy chicken, and limca soda. She placed the tray on my lap and began cutting the meat into manageable pieces. Her purple dress, hastily bought from a boutique in Bodija that morning, had nothing on the ruined one. A couple of friends tagged along, so I just let my eyes tell her how sorry I was and how grateful that she'd brought me food. I wish she'd stay with me, but there was the pin the tail on the donkey, her traditional puppet theatre, and musical chairs. She blew a soft, sweet puff of air on her forefinger, a bubble kiss, pressed it against my cheek, and flitted off like a butterfly. It was our own special way of saying, I love you above and beyond. I was finishing my food when a silver Mercedes pulled up at the gate. Mami Akinro, Father's mother, emerged from the back seat, elegant from her headscarf, a towering blue egele with golden threads sparkling in the sun, to her blue shoes. She always arrived late from Ijebu and left with Father when the party was over. Father went to meet her, removing his cap and prostrating to touch a finger to the ground. She laid a hand on his head, pulled him up, embraced him. They talked for a bit before she went around greeting guests. As her path brought her closer to me, Mother appeared at my elbow, anxiously hovering. Then it was like being in a cage with two lionesses eyeing each other's throats. Without fail, after Mami Akinro visited, Mother would send for Mama Andoh, her own mother. They'd both pray loudly all night and sprinkle holy water from Mama Undo's seraphic temple of holy fire all over the house. If Mami Akinro was headed out the front door, you could be certain Mama Undo was headed in the back. What happened to your arm? I nearly looked around to see whose arm Mami Akinro meant. On her rare visits, she hardly talked to us, though she always brought sweets. I supposed a broken arm was news. Then again, Father didn't ask.
He was too excited about his party and rushed down the stairs and fell, Mother said. I'm asking the child, Abby. Can't he talk?
Mammy's tone could freeze water. Mother turned to me, brow raised.
I fell, Mami, Ma.
I see.
There was a long silence.
Be more watchful in the future.
Yes, Ma,
I whispered. Watchful? What an odd choice of word. Then Mami Akinro's friend was tugging her away, saying she had to meet a new grandchild. And Mother said softly, good boy. Well done. Then she, too, was gone. I struggled out of my chair. On my way inside, I heard two women gossiping.
Hey, did you see the expensive lace Mama Cherie's wearing? Her business has just been booming recently.
I know, But guess what? Her neighbor's daughter suddenly died in her sleep last month. Uh-huh. You saw where my mind was going. I'd long suspected she's a witch. A real Air Force number one, flying out on deadly night missions to ruin lives and bring calamity. They say it was her coven that caused lightning to strike and kill her own sister. I heard. And you should have seen how she cried crocodile tears at the funeral. People are so wicked. Feeling sorry for poor Mama Sherry, who for certain had merely committed the sin of prospering, I slipped into the living room to take my pain tablets. After we'd returned from the clinic, Mother had held out the bottle, telling me to take two every 4 hours. Flashing to that hand, shooting out to push me, I'd shuddered. Something like shame crossed her face before she shrugged and sniffed. Stumbling and falling like a drunk when I barely touched you. I gingerly wedged myself against the wall behind the sofa with an X-Men comic. There was an action picture of Storm I planned to draw. It would have to wait till I could properly hold a pencil again. Someone was urgently tapping my leg. I blinked up into the eyes that looked just like mine. Wake up! Mommy wants us to cut the cake. I'm sorry about your dress. It wasn't you that tore it too. How's your arm? Painful. I began to sit up and winced. Bura grasped my good arm to help. You know, Mommy's sorry, even if she won't say so. I carefully straightened my crumpled up comic. Bura would believe what she wanted. She said she was just urging you to move faster, and next thing you tripped, and it's her job to toughen you up as a boy, or life will be worse for us. Whether Mother meant to or not, she did push me, and I'd never be the son she wanted. Too late, I realized I'd said the last part aloud. The pain medicine was definitely melting my brain. Why can't you see that nobody gets to choose? You could have died and all because... Bora's voice broke. I should never have let you wear my dress. Let's just go before she comes looking. I was suddenly flooded with the dizzying terror and loneliness she'd felt as she frantically called my soul back from wherever it was speeding while my body lay at the bottom of the stairs. Remorseful, I nudged her cheek with a finger, pulled sorry eyes. As she tugged me towards the door, I promised myself once more that I'd never allow Mother's anger to separate us. The cake, which Mother had got around to picking up in the morning, was covered in curly pink icing on one side and blue on the other. When we gathered around it for the family photo, I'd placed my hand atop Wura's. The photographer counted down to one, and together we pushed down the knife, slicing a clean cut in between. Chapter 3. Now, 1991, age 14. I'm nervous, excited, worried, unable to believe I'm really taking this first step towards the life I dream of having, or that my mad, terrifying gamble somehow worked. Mother is reading with painful slowness through my admission papers. Mr. Driver unhurriedly pokes a toothpick about in his mouth. We're idling in a long line of cars, snaking up the road towards tall, ornately decorated metal gates. Welded onto an arch above them is a shield engraved with two cross pens and a globe of the world. Scrolling letters read, International Secondary School, Courage, Truth, and Excellence. I will my heart to climb down from where it's lodged halfway up my neck. My fingers miss the reassuring warmth of Bura's. Nearly every new experience, she's been beside me. Once, in a rare moment of chattiness, Emily described how 10-month-old Wura rose on wobbly legs, braced herself on the sofa, and stretched out her hand. I'd unhesitatingly grasped it, and together we took our first steps. We'd begged Emily to tell it again. She did, once. Mother's maid is the exact opposite of sentimental. We turned 14 this month. There was no birthday party. No one was celebrating. Still, during an awkward outing with mother to buy my long list of boarding school items, 4 different kinds of shoes, a torchlight, padlocks, etc., I spent my small savings on 2 identical wristwatches. Each round face held a tiny map of the world. Last night, I drew a heart and wrote Wura's name on the inside strap of my watch before fastening it on my wrist. She did the same with hers. I promised her that nothing, not time or space, can ever divide us. I reminded her that whatever mother says, I'll never knowingly hurt her. Then we told, remember when, stories, till we fell asleep. Today, she was too sad to come out to say goodbye. But sure enough, when I looked up at her bedroom window as the car peeled out of our driveway, there she stood, hand plastered against the glass. I laid mine flat against the back windscreen in reply and felt the ghosts of our fingers touching. The gates open onto a long driveway lined with old flame trees. Their branches arch from stout trunks, touching in the middle to form a blazing orange tunnel. It's like a passageway to a new world. Hope flutters alive in my chest. I chance another glance at Mother. Since the fateful phone call that cemented her terrified beliefs and set me free, she's only spoken to me to go over the rules. I must, 1, never, ever take off my briefs unless I have utter and complete privacy. 2, always shower with the door locked and a towel within arm's reach. 3, immediately commit harikari if I find myself in danger of disgracing the Akinoro name. Okay, she didn't exactly put it that way. It's just Wura and I have been watching Shogun on TV. She'd even called the school to demand a single room, but was firmly told they're reserved for prefects. We slide behind a long line of cars inching towards a 3-story building vibrant with pink bougainvillea. Paths with neatly trimmed hedges wind into the distance, promising secret places to explore, should I find myself alone and friendless, as always. Hidden sprinklers send a flurry of swallowtail butterflies dancing into the air. They flutter back down like happy children playing buju buju. Beside the building, a marble fountain sits on a many-tiered platform. A flip-tailed fish on top rains sparkles of water into shell-like bowls. Yeyemi's unearthly smile flashes in my mind. I hope she can still reach through the veil to seek me. I decide it all adds up to a good sign. I meant to be here. In the admin office, Mother scrawls her signature on the dotted lines almost as fast as the admin lady points to them. Clearly used to lingering parents needing reassurance, she smiles sympathetically and says, I'll be well cared for at ISS. In reply, Mother snaps that she'll pay cash for the balance of my fees. While Mother counts the cash, the lady hands me a couple of keys with tags attached. Each has my name and a number, 312. One and a spare, she says. Don't lose them. You'll be sharing with 2 others. My worries birth a million more. Who will my roommates be? Will they take one look at me and decide 2 plus 2 equals weird? Have I just jumped from frying pan into kerosene fire? The admin lady is explaining important things like rules and regulations and dorm life, I try to focus. All too soon, we're at the door, and Mother is saying, Otolorin, behave yourself. Don't make me regret this.
Yes, Mother.
It's a sudden, surprising struggle not to beg her to take me home. She nods once and walks away fast. The edge of her long skirt disappears around the corner, and the world tilts sideways, and I'm sliding off and can't stop. My hand is raised towards her when someone bumps into me, says sorry with a wide apologetic smile, and hurries on. I'm jolted back. All around me is life, an electric buzzing like a hive full of happy, purposeful bees. Dragging my giant suitcase and bag, I merge into the crowd. As if drawn by magnets, my eyes fasten on a flock of girls chattering like weaver birds. They look like they've stepped out of Wura's teen magazine. She'd warned me that ISS is nicknamed Fashion Central. In my head, Laurie steps up among them, wearing an off-the-shoulder jean dress I'd drooled over. How warmly they smile, how eagerly they make space for her. In reality, one of the girls is pointing at me, and they're laughing. I've been standing there, staring, smiling like an idiot.
Goodbye, Laurie, I whisper, for now.
From here on out, I will blend in, be the best boy I can, study like mad, and earn that scholarship to America, where they'll know what to do about my body before the worst happens, and it's too late, and I'm forever stuck the wrong way. A long queue has formed outside the boys' dorm. Two men, probably teachers, are sitting at tables beside the door, marking names in big books before letting people in. There are tall boys, short ones, skinny ones, and a few round ones, for sure nicknamed Bokoto, who gamely take it in their stride. There are boys the gleaming black of Oshe Dudu soap, a smattering as pale as fresh milk Wara, and everything in between. Voices high and voices low. Each and every one of them someone's real son. Mother's earlier haste suddenly makes sense. It wasn't just to be rid of me. She must have felt like someone costumed in fake jewelry at a party where other guests wear priceless gems. I want to turn and flee, to keep running till I'm past those wondrous gates and escaping to... Where? Exactly. There's nowhere I'm welcome. My only way out is through ISS. I fall into line. Ahead of me, a thin boy with hawkish features, typical of Hausa northerners, slings an arm over his friend's shoulder.
So, Jim, my man, he crows. I heard you totally rocked London this summer.
Soji, tall and worryingly handsome, flashes a smug grin.
Your head right. Remember Lola, that girl I met there last year? You'll never believe.
They head inside, and I'll never know what happened with Lola while I stand here, twitching like a lamb in ill-fitting wolf's clothing. Which are my roommates? Behind me, an argument rages about whether Kamaka from Hawaii absolutely killed it with last summer's luau or not. And someone else insists he can't blame Kole for skipping a whole week of school after that blurb story. They might as well be speaking Pig Latin in Kanuri. What on earth is a luau? Or for that matter, blurb. Children of rich, well-traveled, highly educated parents have graduated from ISS since 1963. Father, as far as I know, earned his education in the practical world of business, and mother only finished primary school before helping Mama Undo sell fabric. I've hardly left rustic, sleepy Ibadan, except in my imagination. How will I ever fit in? Any minute now, someone will point at me and shout, Imposter! My turn comes, and I drag my bag and suitcase up the stairs. The admin lady said the dorm has 5 floors. First and second year boys share the first 2 floors, third and fourth years the next 2, and final year seniors have the top. At either end of each hallway are shared bathrooms with individual stalls. Except for dorm prefects, she said, it's against regulations for senior and junior students to loiter on each other's floors. It's meant to decrease bullying, which is deeply frowned upon at ISS. This sounds reassuring. Too soon, I'm standing at the door of 312, third floor, room 12, as marked on my keyring. I breathe, exhale, open, and step into light and air. Tall windows line one wall. Beds, closets, and study desks neatly claim the others. A roommate is already there. We stare, startled at each other. Hi, I'm Cornelius, fourth year. He has a long, gentle face, long fingers, and the oddest air of not really being there. Otto, third year, and you. Nice to meet you. It's tradition, the admin lady said, to introduce yourself with your name and year. Same year. That's your space. He points to the only unmade bed. Our roommate is out and about somewhere. I'm off to piano practice. See you later. He leaves. My shoulders descend a notch from around my ears. He didn't seem to find anything about me odd. Still, he had such an absent manner, it seems I might have had 2 heads and he'd not have noticed. My roommates have already claimed the best spots, so my bed is nearest the door, with my closet just beside it. I quickly realize it's perfect, because when the closet door is open, it creates an enclosed area beside the wall where I can hide while changing. As for other boys' bits, the occasional eyeful is something I'll just have to deal with. Hopefully, no one makes a habit of strutting around naked. Cornelius certainly doesn't seem the type. But what of my other roommate? Needing a distraction, I flip open my suitcase and hang my school uniforms, 3 sets of crisp dove grey shirts and darker grey shorts, in the closet. Frantically stack socks and briefs into the drawers, knock a bookend off the desk onto the floor, where it takes vengeance on my toes. I hop around, mouthing bad words for white-hot seconds, till I catch sight of myself, foot in hand, in the wall mirror. A chuckle escapes. I stop, stare into my own eyes, and realize I'll live whole months without mother's anger stalking me like a vulture impatient for its dinner to die. And I made it happen. The dinner bell clangs. I've put away everything and no longer have reason to linger. I inch the door open. A pack of laughing, shoving boys rush past, rowdy as falling rocks. I shut the door fast and lean against it, heart hammering. On my roommate's desk sits a ridiculous eraser shaped like a yellow chicken. I remember Babalawo, his ancient, far-seeing eyes flashing a challenge. All right, I mumble. Take a deep breath and step out. Chapter 4. Before. 1989. Age 12. Had anyone asked me Babalawo's age, I'd have said Methuselah old, because his thin, wrinkled face never changed and his eyes held a whole universe. For as long as I could remember, I'd visited him every 6 months, usually just after my birthday. Mother said it wasn't any of my business to know why, and also to keep my mouth shut about it or else. From which I'd understood that normal children didn't typically visit an Ifa priest. She always dropped me off and picked me up an hour later, never stepping foot out of the car. He was waiting outside his round thatch-roofed hut when we arrived. Mother rolled down the window, her face a tight mask.
Do not return before sundown today. There is much to accomplish, he said.
What? I hadn't planned to return so late.
Your child is 12 and approaching manhood. The oracle says that time is auspicious for what must be done.
He had a voice to be obeyed. Mother's mouth snapped into a grim line. Anyone else would now be blistered raw by a rash of stinging words. One of the reasons her friends were few.
Get out! She hissed at me. I'll be back after 6.
Inside, earthy smells of herbs welcomed me. Here and there stood familiar wooden images, like friends I'd known all my life. I eyed the honey pot, trying not to drool, hoping it was one of those days he'd give me wild honey on the comb, and I'd squeeze out every last drop of sweetness before spitting out the wax. I took my usual seat, cross-legged on a woven mat, and waited for him to begin the ritual of speaking incantations over me while dabbing my forehead and chest with white powder from his divination tray. That was pretty much what happened during our usual hour together. If there was time, he'd tell me a fable or myth, like how Earth was actually a marketplace where the god sent us to trade and learn proper conduct before returning to our true heavenly home. Or he'd share some particularly timely proverb. My favorite was, the thief that stole the king's bugle, where will he blow it? Such simple and deep truth. He'd given me my treasured book of Yoruba proverbs when I wouldn't stop pressing for more. As always, I wished Wura was there, but however much she begged and sulked, Mother refused. Annoyed at being excluded, she long ago stopped wanting to hear about my visits. It's boring anyway, she'd sniff. Nothing new ever happens. Then, it leapt out at me, just like those pop-up greeting cards. Etched among the images, encircling the divination tray, was a woman with a fish's tail and stars circling her head, just like Yeyemi. Had stopped seeing those over the years. Perhaps Babalawo might know something about her and that wondrous place I went. I turned to ask, but he was rummaging in a wooden chest, looking unusually grim. I'd have to wait till he was in a more talkative mood. Instead of sitting across from me, though, Babalawo handed me a white sheet and told me to undress completely, then wrap it around me. He always wore the same, with one end thrown across his shoulder like the Roman togas in my Asterix comics. Surprised, I stood, hoping he'd explain later and not just say, "When you're old enough, all shall be revealed." My sling was gone, but I still winced removing my t-shirt.
"What happened to your arm, child?"
"I fell," I mumbled. It wasn't easy to lie to those deep-seeing eyes. He gently examined my shoulder, shaking his head, then smoothed on some mint-smelling ointment. It felt warm and tingly and immediately better.
"You must be more watchful," he said,
sounding eerily like Maami Akinoro. "Thank you, Baba." I waited till he'd knotted the sheet behind my neck before removing my briefs. Though he knew our secret, Mother's words were branded into my brain. "No one's eyes should ever encounter what you have down there, or they're on screaming." "Ready?" he said. I nodded, suddenly nervous.
"Good. Hold on to this. No matter what."
He held out an ordinary grey pebble. My palm closed around its cold smoothness, My heart started thumping.
Follow me.
He picked up his horsetail divination staff and stepped out of the hut. I stayed in confusion for a moment before rushing after him. We were quickly on a forest path bordered by thick vines hanging off tall trees. Birds shrilled to each other. Something rustled in the thick green bushes. Each minute felt weirder. Babalawo's long, thin legs ate up the ground so fast it took all my breath to keep up. We finally stopped at a clearing where a round thatched roof hut hugged the ground like a giant snail. Around it stood carved people, some tall, poking at the sky, faces dotted with white chalk. Others crouched so low they were bumps on the ground. I heard the soft roar of fast-moving water. I'd never want to be here alone after dark. Babalawo pulled me inside. An old man and a woman I'd never seen before sat very still on grass mats, wearing white sheets like us. Tiny cowrie shells woven into the woman's hair formed a delicate fringe that rippled like water when she turned her cool stare on me. The man, face stretched tight over sharp bones, looked as if he was on some grim mission. I wish they'd smile, or say welcome, or something. Sit down. Babalawo pointed to a mat on the floor.
But, Baba, what?
Hush and listen, child. At 7 days old, your parents brought you and your sister to me for your esetaye, to establish your steps in this world and try to divine your ori, your destiny. The results were ambiguous. We are hoping now you're older, the evidence will be plain and the oracle will speak more clearly.
My parents, I gasped. Father and mother were here with me and Wura?
Babalawo nodded. I was bursting with a torrent of questions, but he held a finger to his lips as the woman came to kneel beside me, carrying a calabash half filled with water. Gray-green leaves floated on top. The other man came to sit beside her. My fingers twisted the hem of my white sheet.
We are gathered today, Babalawo said, to discern this child's unique ori and what interventions might be needed. When he was an infant, I did the casting of palm nuts. Though Ifa spoke in riddles, I understood that his destiny is uncommon and his path would be difficult. But his head is not cursed. Even so, his mother sank into heartbreak and denial.
I stared. Wura had always insisted mother was that way because her heart had broken, but I never understood this before. I thought she simply hated me.
The oracle instructed me to caution her that a person who aims to drag another through a forest must first clear the path with his own back. I'm afraid her bitterness has only grown. Over the years, I've held my peace for the child's sake, but his life was recently put at risk. He said he fell. The oracle said otherwise. For both their sakes, we must seek concrete answers. These steps are not undertaken lightly. Let us begin.
Babalawo knelt behind me, switched his horsetail staff over my head.
It was more information than I'd learned in years. And did he just say he suspected mother of harming me? What were they about to do? My clenched hands were sweat damp. I dared not let go of my pebble, though I had no idea why. I reminded myself that Babalawo had never hurt me. The men started chanting by turns, one taking up where the other left off. They swished the air above my head with their horsetail staffs. Their chant was like the droning of gentle bees.
The ground beneath my mat felt cool and hard. My breathing slowed, despite myself. Baba Lao placed a hand on my good shoulder and firmly urged me backwards till I lay down. He was surprisingly strong for a man who looked so frail. I struggled to rise, but a sharp twinge in my other shoulder reminded me it was still tender.
What's happening? Baba, what are you?
Hush, child. Be still. It was that stern voice he used with mother. Wide-eyed, I watched the other man shift around, turning his back to me, still chanting. I looked pleadingly up at Babalao, but his eyes were shut. I remembered Rashid's face and was immediately sure I was about to be scarified. They'd surely hidden the razor blades. There was a sudden wrongness of air as the woman flicked up my white sheet and patted my legs. Shock bolted me to the floor. Not scarification then, but this couldn't be happening. There was, I thought hysterically, barely anything to circumcise. She crouched forward, bony fingers searching briskly through fold and crevice. In my head, I struggled. Did anything but lie there quaking. Yet I couldn't move. Like those nightmares where something heavy sits on your chest.
Please, I croaked. Please, don't cut me.
Warm liquid pooled uncontrollably under my thighs, and somewhere I died of shame. Now she'd know I didn't even pee from the tip of my tiny nubby pot, but from underneath. Be still, child, Babalao said. We're not here to do harm. Hush, and be still. Tears slid from my eyes, but I kept them wide open, watching now for the moment her face would twist with disgust, like when she found the opening I kept most secret, because mother said its existence was proof of the devil at work. But she just carried on, as if counting a newborn's toes to make sure all 10 were present. Then she dipped her fingers in the calabash and sprinkled water over me, speaking incantations in deep Ijila Yoruba language. I heard cauldron of life and daughter of clay. A moment later, she covered me up, looked me in the eye for the first time and said, Bele, my child, it's over. There's nothing to be ashamed of. Babalao opened his eyes and stood. So did the other man. I sat up and scooted away from them till my back hit the wall, clenched my ankles closed. If I shut my eyes tight enough, maybe I would disappear. I sensed Babalao's approach. A gentle hand wiped the tears from my face. I wrenched away. When you were an infant, we could not circumcise you as custom demanded because things were unclear. We needed to see if the situation had changed as you approached adulthood. Akbetebe is my wife and assistant. She examined you like a nurse or a mother. And Baba Alaba is an onishegun who specializes in herbs and medicines for healing. We seek to uncover the God's intentions and resolve the riddle of your existence so as to guide you onto your true path. For it is ruin to pursue the wrong destiny. He could maybe have told me this earlier, before they scared me witless. And do they still mean to circumcise? The thought had me quivering anew. Forgive the indignity. You would only have tortured yourself imagining worse had I told you what was ahead. Think of it like a visit to a doctor, except here we apply the ancient knowledge of our forefathers, eh? I opened my eyes and reluctantly nodded. The urgent question of circumcision burned on my lips, but my voice seemed gone. He touched his divination chain to my forehead, then pried open my fingers and took the pebble. He joined the others at the opposite end of the big hut, where Akbetebi talked for a long while in quiet whispers. I knew I should be grateful someone cared enough to seek answers, but I just wanted to be back home, with an ordinary body no one needed to examine or cut. I pictured Wura laughing and jumping with her new green skipping rope. I'd been practicing how to hop in with her. Time just right, it worked like magic. The thought calmed me and took my mind off the wet patch on the bottom of my white sheet. I heard the rattle of Babalawo casting his divination chain of 8 linked half shells on the ground. He rearranged and cast it again. "She is quite a wonder," he said. "What? Who?" My eyes snapped wide. "We have here a daughter whose Ori made the most unusual selection in heaven before descending into the marketplace of life."
"Daughter?"
"Obatala was hard at work in heaven, making human bodies for the clay of earth. It was a Sunday when the almighty Odumare expected to breathe life into the most beautiful creations, so he had to take extra care. Obatala was making a female body when his wife, the goddess Imoja, brought him a cooling herbal drink to ease his labors. Unknown to them, Eshu, the trickster god, had laced it with palm wine. Alcohol, as we know, is a war, a thing forbidden to Obatala and his followers because it was while drunk at the beginning of creation that he made disabled bodies. It is his weakness. And so Odumare was disappointed with him when a finished body that looked neither fully male nor female arrived to be animated with life. But Yemoja, feeling guilty for her part in this blunder, offered to specially guide and protect this one as a female, if selected by her Ori.
We have no need for my intervention then.
Baba Alaba asked my most pressing question.
No. Agbetebi confirmed what I couldn't when Otto was a baby. While she does embody aspects of the cosmic god, enfolding both male and female facets of life, her stone whispered that the form which best favors her destiny in this lifetime is female. Yemoja shall be her guide, but she must be taught also to avoid a war, things forbidden to Obatala, so as not to purchase trouble in the marketplace of life. That is the bargain of the gods. Those they will favor, first their burden.
Ashe, Akbetebi nodded, and for the first time, smiled at me. I slumped with relief. My poor knobby part was safe from Baba Laba's razor. And wait, the gods had pronounced me a girl. Every time Baba Lao said the word she and her, he meant me. My heart did this funny little skip, and my breath caught. It was almost too much an abundance of riches, like ice cream with cake with icing on top.
Perhaps as protection from future harm, she could become an acolyte in the shrine.
I cringed into the wall. Every wondrous thing he'd said flying out of my head. What did he mean, acolyte? That I'd forever live there at the Ifa Grove? What about school at St. Christopher's? Who would lend me comics? The encyclopedias I devoured from Aardvark to Zygote told about a huge world out there with pyramids and waterfalls and northern lights. Worst of all, Mother would never let Wura visit. I'd lose her forever. And she was everything. My best friend, my light, my defender. She made me laugh and sang me songs and blew bubble kisses when life was hard. And she needed me too. I chased the spiders out of her room and ate half the beans she hated off her plate when Mother wasn't looking. We belong together. I hid my rising sobs in my palms. Why so sad, child? Babalawo was back beside me.
I don't want to live apart from my sister.
No one will force you. We're just thinking of ways to keep you safe. I'll ask your mother to bring you monthly from now on. Is that better?
Yes.
I sagged with relief. And the examination. I know I'm not normal, and it was necessary,
but it felt horrible. Please, no more.
Never again. We got all the information we need. And remember this, you're both normal and special.
So you all think I'm really a girl?
After years of being beaten for even hinting at this, it still seemed like a trick, like he'd laugh and say, April Fool, even though it was October.
It's the choice your Ori made.
Joy blossomed in my chest. I hugged it close. Mother now had to agree because Babalawo said so.
Can we please go now?
I was desperate to take off the clinging wet sheet. Babalawo nodded. I accepted the small gourd Akbetebi handed me. The cool drink tasted fresh and green, like the scent of rain on long dried earth. Come. Babalawo held out his hand. The herbal drink was so soothing. My feet seemed to plant themselves in the earth with each step, only to get torn out again by the roots. In his hut, I lay on a straw mat and fell fast asleep. Before Mother picked me up, Babalawo tied three strands of beads around my waist. One was as transparent as water. Two gleamed all the colors of a peacock feather.
These represent the deities your Ori selected to guide you through life, he said. Guard them close.
While I admired their sparkle against the bony hollows of my hips, he also tied a small, bell-shaped silver amulet on a leather strap onto my upper arm beneath my sleeve.
Listen, Otto, these prophecies you must fold secure within your heart for when the time is right. First, it is in the heat of the forest fire that the audacity of the Denikoro plant is released. Second, if you remain fixated on where you fell, you will never figure out where you slipped. Third, only after your own self is claimed, may your soul abide safely with you. A thrilling, terrifying sense of power encircled me, and I was swelled high in the air. Around me hovered a full suit of traditional armor like I'd seen on Benin warriors in my history book. It snapped helmet, neck guard, wrist guard, chest plate, ankle bands into place on my body, and I knew in that shining moment that I could cross my arms and stop bullets mid-air like Wonder Woman. I'd never felt this before. Then it was gone, and I was ordinary me again, standing wide-eyed in Babalawo's mud hut.
Remember this also, he said. The eagle, raised as a chicken, must one day recognize itself and choose to fly. Mother had been in such a hurry, honking horn outside, Mr. Driver revving up before I'd shut the car door, that Babalawo barely had time to tell her to bring me monthly before we'd zoomed off as if escaping a raging fire. On the long drive home, I pretended to be asleep, while thoughts chased around my head like harmattan leaves. How mother used to wash Wura top to toe, armpit to armpit, but always stopped at my waist and said, "Wash down there." How I thought it was just another thing mothers only did for girls, till I understood she simply couldn't stand to be reminded of my difference. Yet Baba Lao's wife had examined me and wasn't disgusted. She'd said there was nothing to be ashamed of, when shame was all I'd ever known. Most importantly, Baba Lao finally had answers. Why else would mother take me to him all these years, if not to help us? I allowed myself the rare joy of my favorite daydream, in which some miraculous event happened to make mother become even half as loving to me as she was to Wura. For that, I'd endure almost anything. The words tumbled out as soon as we were in the living room. How Baba Lao said I was special, not cursed. How Obatala made me after Eshu tricked him with palm wine, and Yemoja fought for me, and my Ori selected her to guide and protect me. See, mother, I was right. They said I'm meant to be a girl. I pulled off my t-shirt to show her my beautiful beads, my shiny silver armband. Mother's teeth clenched on an indrawn hiss. Her hand flew at my face and I braced, flinching. The blow never landed. Terror flashed in her eyes, but vanished so fast, I must have imagined it.
"Hey, Jehovah!" she screamed. "Get out and remove those disgusting fetish things and throw them in the dustbin, now!"
She was trembling, eyes wild. I edged around her towards the door, glad we were in the living room downstairs.
"So, this is their final plan to destroy me, eh?"
she whispered as I fled. That night, I couldn't sleep for thinking. Who were they who were planning to destroy mother? Why take me to Baba Lao if it wasn't to help figure me out? What made her halt the hand she'd raised to hit me, looking as if she'd seen her own ghost? Nothing had ever stopped her before. I'd fetched my armband from its hiding place, slid it on, and felt a bit less heartbroken.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.